my country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside let freedom ring. My native country, land of the noble free, thy name I love. I love thy rocks and rills, thy woods and template hills. My heart with rapture thrills like that. Silence break the sound, oh Lord. Our Father's God, to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing.
Prophetess Donna Bratton, servant of the Lord, with Dawn's Heart Belt Corner here. I woke up at 5 a.m. this morning. You know, like I've told you before, some mornings I'll cough. And I had this cough, and I instantly woke up. And I sat there for a few minutes, and then, a few seconds, actually. And then I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me, and we're going to talk in a minute about a tsunami wave near California beaches tomorrow afternoon. Now, when I say tomorrow afternoon, I'm going to talk about this. I've said this before. Remember, God speaks to prophetic servants. It may happen tomorrow, the next day, week, month, or year, but it will happen. Okay? 2 Peter 3:8-10 says, the day of the Lord. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises. Some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. God revealed many prophecies to David Wilkerson, William Branham, about the California, the economy, and the judgment of America. You know, so God will show things to prophetic servants before they happen. You know, remember Joseph, God revealed things to Joseph, and he made it known to the king. Now, I've even asked my husband, you know, maybe God has been showing me these things because we as a nation need to get ready for what's ahead. Because if you remember, I've sent several letters over to President Donald Trump and the administration at the White House. I've spoken with John L. Casey, who is a scientist right here in Orlando, Florida. He's He's in charge of the International Earthquake and Volcano Prediction Center, which is right here in Orlando, Florida. All right. He used to be a White House advisor. All right. And he wrote a book back in 2016, Why Catastrophic Earthquakes Will Soon Strike the United States. And remember, on May 12, 2017, the same day he sent a press release over to Secretary Rick Perry, the Holy Spirit woke me up at early in the morning. I believe it was like 5 a.m. Or 3 a.m., something like that, about move away from the West Coast. And now we are seeing, remember I told you, we're going to start seeing these earthquakes appearing in the United States. And we're seeing more and more. We just had that big earthquake that hit Alaska. And I believe we are going to get hit again here in California. I've said that several times. Now, I don't know if that's the big earthquake. God does not tell me this, okay? He gives me little bits and pieces. This could be the coming before we have one. I don't know. But I do know they're going to be hit, all right? I do believe California will be hit. Warning the imminent threat. Remember, John L. Casey warned the imminent threat to U.S. energy resources and nuclear facilities that their team of scientists detected from years of accumulated research. Let's pray, because I want to get into more of this, but I want to pray first. It's important that we pray. Every time I speak, I want to make sure we invite the Holy Spirit and we pray. So, Father, we just come together in agreement, Lord. We welcome for your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, I ask that you'd speak through me, Lord, what it is you're wanting me to say, and that the people would hear exactly what it is, Lord. And, Father, we just thank you, Lord. We're not going to worry or be afraid, Lord, but our hope and trust is in you, Lord. We're not trusting in man, but we're looking to you, Lord. You warned us about these things that were coming about, Lord, so it's our job to just prepare in our hearts, make sure we're right with you, Lord, because things are going to take place, and it doesn't mean one area, Lord. I believe we're going to see disasters all over in these last days, but we have to make sure we're right with you, Lord, and following you, and be careful where we're headed in these last days. So I ask your will to be done in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. All right, so we're talking about that letter I sent to President Donald Trump, all right, that scientists were warned about the threat to U.S. energy resources and nuclear facilities that their team of scientists detected from years accumulated research, okay? He said our estimates of the damage that could strike as soon as tomorrow, this was back last year, that many millions of Americans could experience earthquakes so large that whole states and regions of the country could be without water and power for weeks or months at a time, okay? And it goes on to talk about the big one coming, all right? We've been warned about that. We're hearing that, all right? We're going to talk about some of this today. You know, I'm just reiterating things that we've talked about. I'm not going to go over through everything. If you're not a subscriber on our YouTube page, you may want to go over there and subscribe so you can hear all the prophetic words that I've given. There's also another website on the front that just has the prophetic words. If you'll go over there and click on subscribe, so because I don't have a URL yet, because there's only 55 subscribers. But remember, when I did send the president a letter, I had seen this video on his YouTube page that was talking about entrepreneurs. I said, I'm not an entrepreneur. I'm not a woman entrepreneur. I'm a woman prophetess. God reveals things to me, the dangers of what is coming upon us as a nation. I told him I want to help organize our nation and what's getting ready to happen. I'll be a prophetic voice, organize, imagine, set up preparations to safeguard our nation in the new era of geophysical danger that is upon us. We as a nation must prepare and get ready for the hard days ahead of us, okay? If we don't start precautions now, there'll be no economy. And I've told you before, all you got to have is a few disasters, and there goes the economy. We've already seen with the wildfires, and you know, people are panicking, the mayor and all this, want more money from the government. Well, what happens when we run out of money? What are we going to do then? We're going to have to go to God Almighty. We can't go to any other God. You know, we're worshiping all these other gods in our nation, all right? Remember Elijah, he worshiped his God, and then the 450 false gods, 450 false prophets worshiped their false god, and their god did not show up. So we cannot worship these false gods. We can't allow all the killing of millions of babies, same-sex marriage, all these things that we're allowing in this nation, okay? And expect God to bless our nation. No, God is not going to bless our nation because it goes against God's word, okay? And so it's important that we follow God's word, you know? And we don't say that we can't have a Christian president, because we can. We can have a Christian president. And it's important that we start looking to God and turning back to God, because I'm telling you right now, we're living in a new millennium. The violence and things are getting worse. People are hardening their hearts, and we're going to need God. I believe God placed President Donald Trump in office for such a time as this. I really, truly believe that, so that we can preach the gospel, get the word out there, and Jesus is coming back. Now, I don't know when. One day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years is like one day. We don't know. None of us knows when Jesus is coming, okay? But we have to make sure we are ready. So I said, if we don't start precautions now, there'll be no calm. It saddens my heart most of God that we have ignored what he's showing us, the calm before the storm. And I got a letter from the CEO, the John L. Casey. He said that his approach is scientific and mine is religious. And then in our own separate ways, perhaps we can get the government's attention. And I said, my prayer is that someone in the White House will pay attention to the signs all around us before it's too late. The lives of the American citizens are at stake, okay? And I said, this needs to be, we need to talk about this on national news. You know, we hate fake news, all right? So let's talk about what is going on. I mean, what about all the weather patterns, the cold weather, the hot water, the floods, the hurricanes, you know? This we don't talk about. And then we're saying climate change. No, it's not climate change. It's called God's judgment. And President Donald Trump said, no, it's not climate change, which I agree with you, President Donald Trump. It's not climate change. It is God's judgment on a nation that is living in sin. You know, what is it? First Chronicles, if my people humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways. You know, that pastor left off the most important verse. Turn from their wicked ways. We have got to have a change of heart. We've got to turn. We cannot keep allowing our nation to go the way it's going, because if it continues on this way, God is going to judge it. We're going to go through things, saints. Mark my words, it's coming. You know, you're seeing it. You know, precept from precept. These earthquakes are getting stronger and stronger. You know, God doesn't do it all at once. He loves us enough to warn us. Okay, but when we don't listen, boom, that's it. You know, it's like your earthly father. They disciplined you. I told you, my father was Italian. And man, we didn't listen. He lit up his eyes. And we knew, hey, we better behave. My brother and I, we'd go over to somebody's house, and we knew we better behave. Because if not, my dad would unbuckle the belt, and we got the belt. My dad did not mess around. You know, nowadays, kids get away with whatever they want to get. We're not going to get into that. But there's no discipline. And see, our Heavenly Father will discipline us. And it's not to punish us. It's because he loves us. He's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. He wants you and I to be a strong bride. He wants us to be able to handle what is coming. All right? Let me just share this with you real quick. We're going to pray for our nation, our president, at the end, I think. I've got so many notes here. I never know where I'm going. The Holy Spirit is showing me. No, God gave me this verse today. I want to read this from Grace for Today real quick to you. Awake, my soul. Our friend Lazarus had fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. Well, you know what? Jesus is getting ready to wake up the church. I'm just telling you right now. Jesus is getting ready to wake up the church. The church is sleeping, okay? It goes on to say, how appropriate Jesus' words are for us today. There are many people who need to be awoken from their indifference, their hopelessness, and their helplessness. They forget that in the midst of all the problems in the world today, it's not only important but also imperative that your whole life should be grounded on your faith in the living Christ. Just as Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, so we raise you from the spiritual stupor and inspire you to live a life of victory, joy, and success in his service. There's a prayer. Lord Jesus, I worship you as the Lord and Savior of my life and commit myself anew to living according to your ways. Amen. And God gave me this scripture this morning. Romans 13:11-13, putting on Christ. And do this knowing the time that now is high time to wake up. Out of sleep. See, we're sleeping, saints. We Christians are sleeping, and God will start with the house of God first, and then he will judge the world. So we know better. God is going to discipline us. Okay. It goes on to say, high time to wake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Verse 12, the night is far spent. The day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly, verse 13, as in the day, not revelry and drunkenness, not lewdness and lust, not strife and envy. See, so we've got to get right. Jesus is coming back. No, I don't know when, but he's coming back. And he wants you and I to be right before him. All right, let's share some news here. All right, and then let me share some news here. Let's go on here a second here. Now, Dutch Sense, I've given you a link before. He talked about there was a very large 7.6 earthquake that struck West Coast, the West Pacific. A tsunami warning was issued, he said. All right. Now, we're seeing more and more of these earthquakes are popping up here. Let me go over to the CSEM map. All right, Southern California is still getting the 2.7 that was 12 minutes ago. All right, I'm not going to read all of them. I'm going to see what's going on here. Nevada, 2.0, 2 hours ago. Okay, Southern Alaska is still getting hit, 4.7, 2 hours and 43 minutes ago. They've been getting hit a lot. All right, Northern California had 2.7 and 2.5 over 3 hours ago. The East Coast of Japan, 4.9, 3 hours and 23 minutes ago. Let me see anything major here. I mean, every few minutes there's earthquakes. Central California, 3.2, and Southern Alaska, 3.3, over 6 hours ago. Let's see on this next page here. Central California, again, 3.2, 6 hours ago. See, so I believe they're going to get hit. It's coming. All right, there's building pressure over there. All right, let's see. The southeast of Loyalty Islands, 5.2 over 7 hours ago. Well, it started back, like I said, 6.7. That was 8 hours ago in the Loyalty Islands. Puerto Rico region, 3.0, 9 hours ago. Where is that? Mexico, offshore Mexico, 3.8. That was over 10 hours ago. There's a bunch of them. I can't even name all of them. There's so many of them. You'll have to go on there. I've given you the links so you can go on there. I want to give you some more news here. Let me find it. Here, hold on 1 minute. We're just going wherever here. Let's see. Now, the stocks. Did you hear about the stocks? Stock market was down almost 800 points. Stocks fell sharply on Tuesday in the biggest decline since the October rout as investors worried about a bond market phenomenon signaling a possibly economic slowdown. Now, I've said this. We're going to see layoffs, and I believe, before Christmas. I could be wrong, but that's what I sense. Okay, about bond market phenomenon signaling a possible economic slowdown. Lingering worries around U.S.-China trade also added to jitters down Wall Street. The Dow Jones Industrial Average fell 741 points, or 2.8%, and was on a pace for its worst day since October 10th, they're saying. At its low of the day, the Dow had fallen more than 800 points. The S&P 500 declined 2.5% to trade below its 200-day moving average as the financial sector lagged. Utilities was the only positive sector in the S&P 500, rising 0.8%, was on a pace for its highest close in more than a year. The NASDAQ composite also dropped 2.8%. Trading volume in U.S. stocks was also higher than usual. The Dow Jones is closed today. I don't know if you heard about that. It's closed today for Wednesday for President Bush's funeral. Now, when have we ever closed the Dow Jones for a president's funeral? That's never happened, all right? I think that's kind of strange. I'm telling you, something's up with that, okay? So we've got to watch and see what's going to happen with that on Thursday. Now, remember, I have given you videos about a strange size waves bewildered scientists, okay? Just before 9:30 a.m. on Sunday, that was November 11th, a series of unusual seismic pulses rippled around the world almost undetected. undetected. The waves rang for over 20 minutes, emanating about 50 miles off the shores of Mayotte, tiny island in the Indian Ocean between Madagascar and Africa. From here, they reverberated across Africa, setting off geological sensors in Zambia, Kenya, and Ethiopia. Now, someone sent this to me. Do you remember? I just spoke this word, and somebody reminded me of it. They said, November 11th, the entire planet shook, and scientists don't know why. You mentioned something happening before this day. And remember, I said that. On 11-2, I had a word. Is November 11th, 2008, a significant day? I was like, wow. You know, and then we're seeing the strange seismic waves that were taking place. All right? Now, there's a lot that's happening. Remember, I spoke about the torrids. There were an annual meteor shower associated with the comet Encke. The torrids are actually two separate showers that I talked about. And I talked about that meteor that hit Russia. Now, we've also witnessed, there's been fireballs caught, I told you, in Fullerton, California, and in Hungary, there was a bright meteor fireball. Now, there has been near close to Earth objects as well. And remember, there was an article that was written that said, apocalypse fears, asteroids will hit Earth with millions heading towards planet now. And then they're saying, it's 100% will be hit, but we're not 100% win. And then they say, the thing that's really most important is we need a comprehensive map showing the location, features, and routes of all these asteroids so we can defend ourselves. And I said, really? I mean, where are we going to run? We can't hide from the wrath of God, the Lamb. I mean, things are going to happen. It talks about Revelation 6, 12 to 14. Revelation 6, 12 to 14. I looked up when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and as the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth, as a fig tree drops its light figs when it's shaken by a mighty wind. Verse 14, then the sky receded as a scroll when it's rolled up, and it's every mountain and island was moved out of its place. Okay, remember, let me see if I can find it. I got so much paperwork here, I don't know if I'm coming or going here. Remember, President Donald Trump, the floodwaters are coming in, and then the death's taken away. Remember that picture? Okay, remember about that dream we've talked about. The last scene, the final part of the dream, we were leaving the field after batting practice. I heard and felt the ground shake. I remember, and then President Donald Trump says, he's wearing his Make America Great Again shirt, and he non-response said very simply, you got to keep praying for me. So we've got to keep praying for our president, whether we voted for him or not, whether you like him or not. You know, I'm not for any president, okay? I'm for what is right in America, and that's what you need to be for. What is right. You know, God commands us to pray for those in authority because the decisions they make will affect you and I. So it's important. Just like the prophetic servants that came to the kings in the old days, I believe that's what we're going to see. You know, so we need to pray that God would do what's right in our nation because we're going to go through things. All right. Let me see what else I want to share with you on this news here. Remember I talked about coming on December 16th, there's a comet, 46P, Wirtanen, or something like that, I can't pronounce the word. A small comet bearing towards Earth is set for its closest flyby in at least four centuries. Here's everything you need to know. Okay, and I put that up there for you to look at. I put that up. All right, let me see. I put this back in order. You know, I have to put all this in order. I don't even know if I'm coming or going here. All right. Now, remember, I had a video I talked about the disasters and economy effects is God's judgment. It's not climate change, okay? And I said that to the president, all right? That I said that, you know, God is going to judge America because we're living in sin. All right, and it's not just America, it's a lot of countries. I mean, they're living in sin. So God is going to judge a nation. Okay, remember we talked about the mass animal deaths. Let's just look at it. You know, I'm just reiterating, talking to you about things we've talked about. The mass animal deaths. All right, we talked about this before. All right. let's see. There's been 360 no mass death events in 66 countries. All right. And this is not all of them listed on this website. There's been 28 whales dead on November 27th in Australia. Remember the 140 whales that died in New Zealand November 26th. The 80 turtles found dead washed up in Cape Cod, Massachusetts, November 25th. In Oregon, there's dozens of birds that they found dead. And in Mexico, 48 manatees on November 16th. November 15th, large fish die off in Colombia. November 13th, all right, Finland. There's been dead fish. 2 tons of dead fish washed up on the beach in Vietnam on November 12th. All right, November 11th, 35 dead turtles and dead fish found in Nicaragua. November 8th, dozens of dead and dying seabirds are saying found on the beaches in New Zealand. 60 tons of fish in the Philippines on November 6th. And it just goes on and on and on. You know, we've talked about that before. Remember in Hosea, I've read the scripture. I mean, this is the biblical. It's in the Bible. Hosea 4, 1 through 3. Hear the word of the Lord, you children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. By swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery, they break out and blood touches blood. Verse 3, therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelt therein shall languish, with the beasts of the field and with the fowls of heaven. Yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. So that's what we're seeing. We're seeing the dead animals, all right? And remember, we talked about the colony collapse disorder and the impact on the economy. When these bees now, they're dying too. What happens if we don't save the bees in time? The bees are dying off, and that means no crops. All right? Effect on the economy. The Western honeybee is the world's premier managed pollinator species. Demand for its services has soared from fruit, nut, and vegetable growers. Among nut producers, almond growers have the highest need for bee pollination. The demand represents almost 100 crop species, making up one-third of the average diet. Bee pollination is worth $15 billion to the U.S. farming industry. So if the bees are dying up, there goes the crops, all right? We've talked about this also. There's coming a famine in the land. I've said that before. I know people don't want to believe it, but it's going to happen. We're going to see a famine in our land. They're already coming out with those RFID chip implants. We're hearing about it, all right? And what about those brain implants being used for healing or control? The times, I said, we're living have changed tremendously. Just look around you. Our world is filled with hate and violence. This is the new world order being unveiled before our eyes. Remember, in Revelation 13, 11, 18, it talks about the beast from the earth. Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon. Verse 12, and he exercises all authority of the first beast in his presence and caused the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. Verse 13, he performs great signs so that even makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. Verse 14, and he deceives. See, he's out to deceive. See those who dwell on the earth by those signs, which is granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who is wounded by the sword and lived. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. He caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark in the right hand or on their foreheads. That's a mark. And that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here's wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast. For it's the number of the man, his number is 666. So you won't be able to buy or sell. All right? Money is not going to be worth nothing. All right? And they're already, like I said, doing these implants, getting people accustomed to this. So that people will say, okay, well, they'll go ahead with it. But if you take that mark, you will die for eternity. If you're left here and you're listening to me and you refuse to give your heart and life to Christ, do not take that mark. I can't stress that enough. Do not take the mark of the beast. All right? I'm seeing if that's it on there. You know, maybe we should pray right now. Maybe you're listening to me. And, you know, this is all new for you. And, you know, you don't know Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In your little word, you see things that are taking place and that are happening. You know, I don't know everything in Revelation, but God talks about it. It's in the book of Revelation. And we're living in the last days, and we're seeing things that are happening right before us. But you don't need to be worried, fearful. You just need to make sure you're right with Christ. Things are going to happen. None of us knows when our last day is. You know, for those that don't know, I was in a car accident in 2000. I had brain surgery on the right side of my brain. I should have been dead. My hair's grown out. You can't even notice it. I'm a walking miracle. I remember being in the hospital. I was unconscious for about 4 weeks. I wasn't dead. I had dream after dream. I was born again. I wanted to do my life over again. And the thing about it, you can't do your life over again. Once you're dead, you're dead. And I told you, something's going to happen and some people are going to die instantly. You're not going to get a second opportunity to give your heart and life to Christ. Now may be your only opportunity, but don't wait. Don't keep putting it off for a later day. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. None of us knows. All right. We're here 1 minute and we're gone the next. You want to make sure your salvation is secure. You want to make sure you know Christ, because whether you live or die, you will spend eternity with our Heavenly Father. For those that don't know Christ, no, you're not going to spend eternity. There's a hell and there's a heaven. All right. I know we don't like to talk about it. You know, even in church, we don't even talk about it. In the old times, they used to have those tent meetings, they used to talk about hell. We don't talk about that no more. Yes, there is a place of hell. And, you know, God did not prepare that place for you. He doesn't want you to spend eternity in hell. He wants you to spend eternity with Him in heaven. All right? If you don't know Christ today, and God is talking to you, and He's knocking at the door of your heart, let Him in today. Let's pray. You know, I know there are those that, doesn't matter what I say, you've been hearing me say this, you're not going to receive Christ. All we can do is pray for you. Pray that you will give your heart and life to Christ. I can't make you. God's not going to force you. He's not going to twist your arm. You know, that is a decision you have to choose on your own, whether you're going to serve God or not. You know, so you need to make that decision. No one else is going to make that decision for you. If you'd like to receive Christ and you want to make sure your eternity is secure in the Lord. So whether you live or whether you die, because it doesn't matter how old we are, you know, things can happen to any of us. We can get hit by a car. We can have a heart attack. We can get killed. Anything can happen. All right. But make sure you're ready. If you'd like to pray with me, I want to pray with you. Bow your head with me and just repeat this prayer and just mean it in your heart. God hears you. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I am a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me and wash me in your blood. Come into my heart and save me. I believe you died for me, Jesus, to give me eternal life. I receive you now, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior." Amen and amen. That's all you have to do, but you have to mean it. You can't just say a prayer and then just go on your way and forget what you pray. No, you have to mean what you say. If you mean business, God means business. So no matter what you're going through in life, God will be there for you. That's the neat thing about God. You know, I am so thankful to God. Yes, we've had our struggles. Daniel and I have had our things, but I can always count on Jesus to be there for me. No matter what I've gone through, God is there. And it doesn't matter what time of day it is, hour, night, midnight. You know, there's been times, you know, and for those that don't know, I've said it several times, you know, my breathing's better, actually. It's cool now. You know, I've had problems with my asthma, you know, and it's actually been better because I eat better. I take care of my temple, so I don't use my inhaler maybe once. I don't use it like I used to. I don't use my big one, you know, that I used to, you know, like plug it in. I forget the nebulizer. No, I don't use that. God, it's awesome. And so, but I've always had a problem where if I eat dairy or cheese, I should say, not dairy, because I can have a little. But if I eat cheese, it does something in my throat and when I swallow. And so I need to make sure I stay. But I've had problems where, I mean, where I wasn't, where I couldn't breathe, but it was like stuck in my throat. And Daniel, he panics, you know, and I tell him, just pray. You know, and God is amazing because it just comes out. And I said, God, you are awesome. Our God is awesome. I mean, when I first had my accident, I would slip and I'd fall. I remember having coffee in my hand. And I fell down and I went hands down first. And I said, God, you're awesome. That's how much God loves you and I. Do you understand that? God is amazing. If you don't know Christ and you still have not prayed, the prayer is up on the screen. You can do it now. You know, so no matter what you're going through life, in life, you can always call on Jesus. He sticks closer than a brother. I mean, he's there all the time. It doesn't matter what you're going through. God is always there. And maybe your husband or your wife walked out on you. Maybe you feel all alone. I mean, I know what it feels. Danny and I don't have many friends. It's just us. And I have my dad where I call. But we don't have a lot of people. It's just us. And you may be by yourself right now. But know that God is there. You're not alone. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He loves you. All right. I just want you to know that. You know, I want you to know how much God loves you. All right. I think that's it. Let me share this encouraging word. By Marsha Burns, Prophet Russ. Marsha Burns said this, and I thought this was neat. She said she had a vision. She saw a turtle retract its head and legs into a shell, and she heard the Lord say, this is a time when you need to retreat from external chaos and establish yourself in a place of peace and quiet. See, God wants to spend time with you, so you have to get away with the Lord. She says, if you are to hear my still small voice, you must be silent. Quiet your flesh and seek tranquility. Zechariah 2:13, be silent, all flesh, before the Lord, for he is aroused from his holy habitation. Prophet Russ said this, the Father says today, I'm your righteousness. You don't have to try to be good enough, for that is only religious striving. I hear you when you call. It is not necessary for you to raise your voice as though you don't have my attention. The fact that you are in distress only indicates that I'm about to enlarge you and magnify my mercies over your life. Amen. You know, sometimes I know I say, I'll be yelling at God. You know, God heard us the first time. We don't have to keep telling him over and over again. I love that. All right. Let me get back to what he said. The fact that you're in distress only indicates that I'm about to enlarge you and allow the enemy to make merchandise of you or to turn you into some cautionary example of one who believed yet did not receive the promise. My heart towards you is yes and am. Amen, says God. So trust in what I'm about to do. I have set you apart for myself, says the Father. Get your focus off the outward turmoil in your life and come into the place of communion and union with me. Offer up to me in the secret place the sacrifices of praise and worship from your lips. As you express your trust in me and your reliance upon me, even so, the word will come and the report will surface that the battle is over and deliverance has come. Amen. There can be no other outcome for you, says the Father, for I am increasing the corn of your bounty and the wine of my gladness within you beyond measure. You will lay down in peace and sleep, secure in the knowledge that tomorrow is another day, and therein will be found the full deliverance and blessing that you've cried out to me for so plaintively. You know, I got another word. I had gotten a word at 5 a.m., but I got another word I'm going to share with you. The Holy Spirit gave this to me. He said, trust the outcome. I heard him say this morning at about 7:46 a.m. He said, trust the outcome. God is bringing everything into acceleration. It's almost that time, I heard him say. The foundations around you and I are about to shake. That is why I keep saying, be built on the solid rock, Christ Jesus. And I've said that several times. Matthew 7:24-29, the wise and foolish builders. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. Verse 26, but everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. The rain came down, verse 27, the streams rose and the winds blew and beat against that house and it fell with a great crash. Verse 28, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority, not as their teachers of the law. Your world is about to shake. Everything that is not of Christ will go on the wayside. Only that which is of him will remain. Hebrews 12:25-29. We've read this several times. It talks about it. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. Verse 26, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he's promising yet once more, I will shake not only the earth, but also heaven. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of these things that are being shaken as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. It is going to happen whether you want it or not. That's right. I've said this before. It's coming whether we want it or not. Question is, are you ready? Are you ready for what God is about to do? If not, make sure your heart and life are right with Christ. Call on him today. Everyone that calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Today, if you hear his voice, do not ignore it like those caught in sin long ago. Hebrews 3:12-15 says, see to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you have a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it's called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Verse 14, we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. As has just been said in verse 15, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. All right. Now, we've already prayed. I don't know if I'm going to stop this or not. They may put a strike on it, but I might just keep going because the word I'm going to share is not going to be very long here. So let's just share this. You know, just the other day, just yesterday, I think it was, I shared a word. Are you ready to cross over the Jordan into your promised land? It's getting ready to happen, saints. God's getting ready to move. All right. Go listen to that video. It's on our YouTube. Where there is no vision, my people perish. I've given you that before. Is God giving you vision? Habakkuk 2:2-3. Though the vision tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. We are about to see God fulfill his vision. And the babies are getting ready to be born. We've talked about that before. Let's talk about this real quick here. About what God said to me this morning. All right. Tsunami wave near California beaches tomorrow afternoon. Now remember, I told you, one day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years are like one day. So this may be something that's coming. All right? I don't know. I'm telling you what I heard. So it's important that I let you know, because if not, God will hold me accountable. Your blood will be on my hands. So I want to make sure I'm doing what the Lord is telling me. All right? So at 5 a.m., I started coughing, and immediately I woke, and then I heard the Holy Spirit say to me, there will be a tsunami wave near California beaches tomorrow afternoon. That is the same tsunami I told you earlier that was headed to the United States. This wave that is coming will creep up on them suddenly. People, houses, and buildings will be swept away instantly in a flash, I heard the Holy Spirit say. Definition of the word flash: appears suddenly, move, or happen quickly. There will be no time to react. Definition of the word react: to act in opposition to a force or influence, move, or tend in reverse direction. Now, if you remember, I talked about this. That gentleman that had a vision of a closing curtain, firestorms, and wave of the future. All right, I've talked about California's going to split now. I've told you about William Branham. He had a vision, he fell off his horse, he was in the hospital, and he had a little ham radio and said, where is it? Hold on. He said, move, California's going under. Where is it? I got so much here, I don't even know if I have it here. But you can go listen to it, it's on our YouTube. All right, I'm not going to find it right now. But he was talking on a ham radio and said, California is going under. So he had a vision, he saw men with beards and women with short skirts back in, I think, was it 1937, when that wasn't even possible back then. All right, so this person I told you that used to sit under Wesley Broderick, he was sat under Todd Bentley, which I don't agree with his interpretation. Todd Bentley fell under God's grace, and he interpreted different than what the Holy Spirit was showing me. He said this, remember, in the first part, closing the curtain in the spirit. He said, I saw a curtain that went from the heavens to the ground and stretched from the northernmost point of California to the southernmost point of California. I knew that it was not just the bordering states that were unable to see California, but all the states. California was now hidden from the rest of America. When I asked the Lord what has happened, he said, California is changing. So contextually, California was being separated from the rest of the states. And there's been other prophetic sermons besides myself that says that California is going to split in half and that we need not try to separate Israel. All right? Separating Israel with the Palestinians. In the second part of the firestorms, he says, what I saw in the next part of the vision was not literal, but spiritual is what he said. But it was. We've seen California on fire this year. All right, and we saw it last year, and God told me that California was going to go up in flames. And I was like, I'm not telling the people. They're going to think I'm crazy. And right afterward is when they started having fires there in California. And we've seen it this year as well. All right, he goes on to say, I was brought beyond the current where I could see all of California from an aerial view. From within, there was a sense of calm. They were not wild or uncontrollable fires by any means, but very much control is what he said. As it got closer, the fires saw they were not fires at all, but actual homes. And at that time, I said, California is on fire in the natural, in the homes as of now. The third part, I said, the wave of the future is what he said. But I believe God was showing him what's coming about that tsunami. While participating on a Facebook broadcast, he said, I went to a vision off the shores of Orange County, California. I saw a large wave, he said, begin to form. It's quickly growing massive momentum as it approached the beach. This wave was epic proportion. Though I don't surf, he managed to be a surfer's dream. And remember, I told you, I believe it's going to be on national news. I believe we're going to see something, all right? That's my opinion. I know other people may have different opinions of it, but that is what the Lord was showing me. All right, let me see what other words I have here. I've got so much going on here. Let me see what else I want to tell you. Okay, we've talked about this, about the larger earthquakes that are now taking place that we're seeing that are happening. Hold on a second. I think I told y'all that. God didn't really say much about that tsunami. He just did what I just shared with you, that it's going to head towards the beaches. That's what he said to me. All right. He said, make your decision today. Will you serve me or the world? Your world is passing away quickly. Today, if you commit your life and put your trust in me, says the Lord, I will give you eternal life. Without me, says the Lord, you are dead in your sins. The only way you can have eternal life is calling on me, Christ Jesus, to save you. What will your choice be? See, God wants to save people. There are people that are going to die. Joshua 24:15 says, and if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself to say whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You cannot serve more than one God. These gods are false and not the true God. There can only be one God, and his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. That's right. There's not many gods. There's only one God. Everyone that calls upon the Lord will be saved. Isaiah 44:6. There is no other God. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. And I said, maybe you are saying I'm Jewish and not a Gentile. If that's what you're saying. All right, Jesus Christ is God of the Jews and Gentiles. You must put your faith in Christ and believe. Without faith, you and I cannot receive anything. So we've got to come to God in faith. I want to read you the scripture, Romans 3:21-30. This is from the easy-to-read version, How God Makes People Right. Verse 21, but God has a way to make people right and has nothing to do with the law. He has now shown us in a new way which the law and the prophets told us about. God makes people right through their faith in Jesus Christ. He does this for all who believe in Christ. Everyone is the same. Verse 23, all have sinned and are not good enough to share God's divine greatness. Verse 24, excuse me. They are made right with God by His grace. This is a free gift. They are made right with God by being made free from sin through Jesus Christ. Verses 25 through 26. God gave Jesus as a way to forgive people's sins through their faith in Him. God can forgive them because the blood sacrifice of Jesus pays for their sins. God gave Jesus to show that He always does what is right and fair. He was right in the past when He was patient and did not punish people for their sins. In our own time, He still does what is right. God worked all this out in a way that allows Him to judge people fairly and still make right any person who has faith in Jesus. Verse 27, so do we have any reason to boast about ourselves? No reason at all. And why not? Because we're depending on the way of faith, not on what we have done in following the law. Verse 20, I mean we are made right with God through faith, not through what we've done to follow the law. This is what we believe. God is not only the God of the Jews, He is also the God of those who are not Jews. There is only one God. He will make Jews right with Him by their faith, and He will also make non-Jews right with Him through their faith. So in order to come to Christ, I said, you have to come to God in faith. All right? Hebrews 11, 1 through 12. We read that before. I'm not going to read it all. You can read it in your spare time. We have got to come to God in faith. All right? Now, we've already prayed. If you still haven't received Christ, you need to do it now. Don't keep putting off. I'm going to read you this poem. Today is a day of salvation. Today is a day of salvation. Now is a time of God's favor. You will not go on vacation. Here today and gone tomorrow, you will never come back. That is a fact. That's right. There's no vacation. And once you're dead, you're dead. You're not going to come back and be something else. Many do not believe in life after death. They believe once you're dead, you're dead. Where will you make your bed? Heaven is a place of sweet peace. All your troubles in life will cease. Hell was prepared for the devil and his angels that fell. Everyone's life comes to a final end. Breathing, pulse, and heart stop. No one can help, not even a paramedic or a cop. You may be young or old. Don't put your salvation on hold. God leaves the decision up to you. What will you do? Make your salvation sure. Give your heart and life to Jesus. Jesus will make you pure. He is the only cure. That's right. Jesus is the only cure. If you haven't said the prayer, here it is. Repeat it with me. Say, dear Jesus, I believe you died for me. Just say it from your heart. Say, Jesus, I believe you died for me. Come set me free. Cleanse me from within. Wash all my stains away. Live in my heart and stay. Thank you, Jesus, for this brand new day. Just say that to the Lord. Just call Him. He's there. 2 Corinthians 6, 2. In the time of my favor, I heard you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. That's 2 Corinthians 6, 2. All right. I'm going to play this song since we put it all together. I've decided. Make your decision. Are you going to follow Jesus or are you going to follow the world? Let's play this song. We're going to end it with this.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
There's no turning back.
No turning back.
There's no turning back.
The world behind me, the cross before me. Yes, the world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me.
There may be none that go with you. Make your decision today. Are you going to serve Jesus? Are you going to serve the world? Our world's passing away. It's going quickly. Make your decision.
Don't go with me. was turning back. I have decided,
yes,
to follow Jesus. I have decided,
make your declaration,
to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
There's no turning back. No turning back. We can't go back. There's nothing to go back to. Remember, was it Peter? The disciple said, Lord, where else can we go? You hold the words of eternal life. There's nowhere you can go. We're either going to go to heaven or we're going to go to hell. We don't get it in between. We have to make our decision. Are we going to follow Jesus or are we going to follow the world? All right. The world's on its way to hell. I don't want to follow the world. I want to follow Jesus. All right. Let's pray saying, let's pray for our nation. Let's pray for all of us. Let's pray for our president. Father, we just come together as the body of Christ, Lord. We lift up America, Lord. We pray for our nation, Lord. I believe we're about to see some changes, Lord. They're about to take place, Lord. We pray for our president. We pray for the Trump administration, Lord, that they would turn their hearts back to you and start seeking you, Lord. As they witness and see all these things that are happening, Lord. And I pray the letters that I've sent to the White House and to those on email and to others, Lord, those words of warning, Lord, would reach somebody in the White House, not just my letters, but others as well that have been warning, Lord. We're believing, Lord, that you're about to move, Lord. So I pray, Father, for all of us that you'll keep us safe in the days ahead, Lord. We pray for those that don't know you, Lord, to give their hearts and lives to you, Lord. There's going to be disasters all over. It's not going to be in one area, Lord. I pray we'll be at the right point and place at the right time. We ask for you to lead us and guide us, Lord, that we'll just not go here or there, wherever we choose, Lord, but that we'll be led by your Holy Spirit in these last days, Lord, because there are things that are happening all around us, Lord. Help us to be aware, Father. We're not going to worry. We come against that spirit of worry. We come against that spirit of fear right now in Jesus' name. Our hope and trust is in you and not in man, Lord. But we do pray for our president. We lift him up, Lord. We pray that he makes the right decisions, Lord, that he'll not try to separate Israel, Lord, and that we'll walk rightly and remove the sins that are going on in our nation, Lord. Because, Lord, you cannot heal and bless America when our nation is living in sin, Lord. We're seeing things are happening more and more. The days are evil. Lord, I pray, oh God, that we would just walk right with you. And that, Lord, you keep us safe, Lord. Keep the Christians safe that are seeking you, Lord. And that you'll bring us home at the appointed time. You won't be 1 second late, Lord. Your timing is perfect, Lord. We trust you, Lord. We trust you. I believe that the best days are ahead of us, Lord. You said we will do greater miracles if we but believe, Lord. And we believe, Lord. We're about to do those greater miracles that you've promised us, Lord. We believe and have faith, Lord. You can do anything, Lord. Now I pray that you would protect our economy, the people's jobs, Lord, and our food, water, shelter, all the daily things, that Lord, that we take for granted. Forgive us, Lord, including myself, all of us, Lord. We have a lot to be thankful for. Help us to praise you and thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your hand of protection upon us and this nation, Lord. Thank you for those in the military that are serving, Lord, and looking out for the people of America, Lord. Thank you for them. Thank you for all those that are in jobs doing what you've called them to do. There are people that you've called, Lord, and we thank you for them that are doing your will, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Now we look to you, Lord. I ask you to meet the people's needs, whatever their need may be today, Lord. Maybe they're out of work or they need healing in their bodies. I speak healing over them right now from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet. Their financial needs, Lord, that you'd bless them, Lord. Help them get out of debt if they're in debt, Lord. Whatever their need may be. Maybe they're feeling lonely, lost a loved one, or maybe they feel like they're by themselves, Lord. Let them know that they're not alone, that you're right there with them, Lord. Now I ask you to go with us, Lord, and lead us, Lord. Lead us and guide us. We take one day at a time, Lord, trusting you today in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen. All right, saints, today is Wednesday, December the 5th. I can't believe, can you believe it? This year's almost over. Don't get so involved with the world. I'm going to tell you right now, everyone's involved with their Christmas shopping and all that. That's not important. I'm going to tell you right now, we're about to see something that's about to take place, which is going to be more important than the worldly things. You know, we've got to get our eyes off the world and get our eyes back on Jesus. That's what's happening with the saints. They got their eyes on the world. Get your eyes on Jesus. And that's for all of us, Lord. Help us to turn our eyes towards you and crucify our flesh, Lord. Our flesh has a mind of its own and wants to do its own thing. So I ask you to crucify in Jesus' name. All right. We're praying for you. We love you. We ask you to keep us in your prayers. Like I said, I believe something's coming. Like I said about the tsunami wave, I don't know when it's coming. All right. But I am making it known to you. Okay. We need to be on watch because things are going to change. All right. All right, I want you to know we love you. We're praying for you. Please keep us in your prayers. Before I end this program, God always reminds me, because we're not in the money. I'm not in the money. If you would like to help us and you see that God is using our ministry and speaking into your life, we have three prophetic servants. I mean, not prophetic. Gifts. But I can't even get the words out of my mouth. We have three partners. I don't know where that came from. We have three partners that give monthly, and we thank God for them, all right? We think, and you know who you are. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for partnering with us. And I'm going to ask if there's anyone on here that would like to partner with our ministry. Please do. You can go on our website at www.dawnsheartfeltcorner.org. You'll see my blonde hair. You can partner on there. There's a place you can partner. You can send a gift right now through PayPal and come directly to us, heartfeltcorner10@gmail.com. You can send a Dawn's Heartfelt Corner P.O. Box 161273, Altamont Springs, Florida 32716. And I'll list all the information on there. You can put your prayer need on here on YouTube. Also at the heartfeltcorner10@gmail.com, the same place you can send your PayPal. Now, if you have a larger gift you want to send in the mail, we are a 501c3 ministry. We can write you up a tax deductible sheet if you ask us. All right, I think that's it. I'll put all that information on there. Just be obedient to God because it's all about God and what he wants to do. He's getting ready to raise up new ministries in this last thing, ones that you've never heard of. And I know God's getting ready to raise up Dawn's Heartfelt Corner, and we give Jesus the praise, honor, and glory. Hallelujah. Get ready. God's about to do some new things in your life and in our life. All right. We'll talk to you soon. God bless you.